Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Bullpen. He's back. Actor extraordinaire, Mr. Ilan Muallem is on the program to debate again today. Dear sir, good to have you back on the show. How are you?
I'm good, thanks. How are you doing?
Doing quite well. Today we're going to chop it up about gun rights, the right to bear arms, things like that. Maybe even get into some constitutional carry dynamics, because the state of Florida is very close to signing a constitutional carry bill that would make the majority of states constitutional carry states. We'll get into that during the show. I don't want to presume what you know or believe about the right to bear arms. So if you would, give us your sentiment and I will then opine.
Well, I'm a supporter of the Second Amendment, but beyond that, I feel like the United States has an illegal gun circulation problem. It's unfortunate. So part of the way to, you know, protect yourself is obviously having a firearm. There's a lot of data to support it. The University of Pittsburgh found that 80% of gun crime was illegally obtained firearms. So obviously it's coming from illegal firearms. University of Chicago found that only 3% of gun crimes were committed with guns bought in a store. According to the 2021 National Firearms Survey, they estimated that guns are used in defensive incidents over 1.6 million times per year. And CPRC found that armed citizens stopped at least 34% of active shooters. So there's a lot of data to support the necessity, unfortunately, in our country of legal gun ownership.
Yeah, so I support the Second Amendment as well in its proper format and context. Yes, I am a supporter also of common sense statutory dynamics. Let me ask you a question.
Sure.
This new thing called constitutional carry really has swept conservative states like a rocket. Now you have the state of Florida about to pass possibly a constitutional carry law as well. For the viewers, constitutional carry simply means you do not need a prerequisite to carry a firearm, no license, no permit, etc. It is a constitutional right, and because it is a constitutional right, there's no requirement for a registration, permit, etc. And that is the doctrine or the logic behind it. Do you agree with the ideology of constitutional carry?
Well, I don't think that it makes any measurable difference in the number of homicides at the end of the year. I don't think
when
that
you say measurable difference.
Yes.
What does measurable difference mean?
It means I truly don't believe more people will die at the end of the year, whether we have constitutional carry or you have to go get a permit for it.
Gotcha.
Again, go ahead.
Yeah, I'm glad you have a belief, but I'm talking about your actual opinion on the law of constitutional carry. Are you?
I support constitutional carry. Yeah, I support background checks also for buying a firearm. But once you have a background check, the truth is, if you're going to go get a background check, buy a firearm, and your plan is to hurt people with it, and you want to carry it around, and you're a criminal because you're actively willing to kill people with it, whether you have the right to legally carry that or not, you're going to carry it. So it's the purchasing of the gun that would be the initial problem, not whether you're concealing it and legally allowed to conceal it or not.
Okay. So I'm going to get back to that in just a moment. Under the constitutional carry law, law enforcement, they are barred. They are prohibited from asking anyone if they are lawfully in possession of a firearm. Constitutional carry makes it illegal for an officer to say, hey, can I see a permit for that firearm? Or, hey, do you legally have the right to possess that firearm? It makes it illegal for an officer to engage based on them seeing somebody with a gun, number one. Number two, if you—
Well, that's not true. Not seeing someone with a gun. In other words, they can't make an assumption that you are committing a crime just based on the fact
that you may not
have a firearm. There's no reason why a police officer should assume you have a firearm and then ask you if it's legal.
Right. I'm submitting to you the absolute truth of the statute. It prohibits, it bars, it makes illegal an officer asking a person, do you have a permit? Are you in lawful possession of the firearm? You can check out my facts statutorily.
You're not understanding what I'm saying. That's because firearms are legally allowed to be carried. So there's no assumption that you're committing a crime. A criminal who's carrying a firearm will conceal it to commit that crime. So the cop would not see it. If you're openly showing your firearm. Sorry, go ahead.
What I've said to you is not contrary to a fact. I'm just telling you what the law says.
Sure.
The law says officers cannot, It doesn't say possibly won't. It says they cannot ask this information of you, period, if they see you with a firearm. So let me move on to the constitutional dynamic of constitutional carry. I get it. It is the right to bear arms being protected. Remember, the Constitution does not give you rights. It simply protects the rights that you have. That is the sentiment of the Constitution. Mm-hmm. So if you believe that there should not be a prerequisite, there should not be a permitting process in order for you to have a gun, all right, because you believe that it is a right, correct? Let me ask you this question. Do you believe voting is a right?
But I just said I believe there should be background checks.
No, no, I'm not talking about background checks, dear brother. I'm asking, do you believe voting is a right?
Sure, you should show an ID, just like you should show an ID to buy a firearm. Okay. I don't see any difference between the two.
Okay. Should you show an ID in states that are constitutional carry?
To buy a firearm, yes. You mm-hmm. should still be obligated to show an ID and have a background okay. check.
Why do they not do that?
They do. Good luck buying a gun without a background check. I bought guns in numerous states, every single state. In fact, there was a study done, mm-hmm. and I will personally send it to you because I know you're going to ask me where it came from. And they sent out agents to actually see if firearms could be purchased without mm-hmm. a background check at gun shows where they're not required. No one was willing to sell a firearm at those. And less than 1% of gun crimes, like guns bought for gun crimes,
right.
are purchased.
So let's do this. Let me go ahead and let me do the numbers for you. So in the state of Georgia, 38%, and this is from the Sheriff's Association for the state because they keep track with these things. 38% of guns that were sold in the state of Georgia were sold by way of no background check because it was a private gun-to-gun sale. Private gun owner sold to a private purchaser. 38%, damn near 40% of all the guns that were purchased in the state of Georgia did not require a background check. I do find your point of view interesting because I actually agree with it. I agree that universal background checks should be a norm. I agree with that. I also agree that the law is hypocritical when it comes to constitutional carry. If you're saying that you don't need a permit, you don't need to go to a licensing department in order to have a firearm because the right to bear arms is constitutionally protected, well, your right to vote is constitutionally protected, but you do have to register. You still have to present an ID or some other form of identification.
There is a process
to engage. My point is the laws are contradictory. Even if you believe in the universal background check like I do, you have to admit that the laws contradict on this matter as it relates to constitutionality.
No, because you're comparing a voting registry to a gun registry, which are two vastly different things.
No, that's not a gun registry, sir. As a matter of fact, most Americans are in favor.
We're in agreement. You should show your license and you should do a background check. And that's fine. If your whole argument is that there should be background checks for when you purchase a firearm to make sure that you aren't admitted to a hospital ever for, you know, any severe mental illness and that you haven't committed a crime, we're on the same page. Yeah, 100%.
Well, and I think we're about 90% there. So I probably take it a step further. Let me tell you why I take it at. If you're going to pass laws that say constitutional carry, because this is a right, you don't need to present anything to exercise this right. But in order to exercise the right to vote, you must present A, B, and C to exercise that right. I think there's a hypocrisy in the way we look at both of these constitutionally protected rights. So that's my submission. Let me go to some of the numbers from the NRA. According to the public policy polling survey, 83% of gun owners, they support expanded background checks on the sale of all firearms. 72% of NRA members support the same. So you're in good company, dear brother. Most people who own guns, most people who are members of the NRA agree with you and I. Also, a poll by the University of Chicago Harris School of Public Policy, it shows that 71% of Americans say that all gun laws should actually be stricter. You also have another poll that shows 88% of everyday Americans believe that we should have a universal background check on all gun purchases. My question to you is this. If the majority of gun owners believe it, if the majority of NRA, paying NRA members believe it, and the majority of Americans believe it, both black, white, brown, male, female, Democrat, Republican, independent, tell me why this is not a uniform policy in the United States of America, because the only entity who doesn't want it are gun manufacturers. Those are the only entities who do not want this, even though everybody else does. Help me understand why.
Well, again, I mean, I've never been able to purchase a firearm without a background check. So,
that is not the statistical reality for people all across the country. My question is, why not uniform the policy if everybody says it's a good policy, including you?
I'm not a policymaker. I mean, I don't answer questions for why people do or don't do things. What I do know is even within that, I think that the entire debate gets very convoluted because the vast majority of firearms, again, are illegally obtained handguns. That's what's being used to, unfortunately, kill the vast majority of people in our country when you look at homicides. And no one's actually looking at the solution for that. We keep debating over things that wouldn't necessarily measurably reduce homicide at the end of the year when we all agree that illegal firearms are terrible and we should tackle that as a full solution first.
Let's
and
then, talk about
right, we can move on to, I don't know why there's not universal
background check. Well, is not a universal background check statute because the gun manufacturers oppose it. So it doesn't matter that the majority of Americans are for it, the majority of gun owners are for it, the majority of NRA members are for it. As long as the gun manufacturers are against it, it won't get passed because of special interests. I hope that helps you understand the why. So let's go back to what you said about illegal guns. What makes a gun illegal?
Well, if it gets stolen, or you're right, if it gets essentially passed along into the funnel of being an illegal firearm, primarily being stolen.
Did the gun start as an illegal firearm?
Yeah, but that's irrelevant. We have hundreds of millions of illegal firearms in the country. So to start not
I'm going somewhere. I'm making a point, dear sir. Because what makes it illegal is a transaction that happened at some point in the journey of that firearm, correct? Because it started as a legal
primarily firearm. Being stolen. Yeah, primarily yeah. being stolen.
Right.
That's the vast majority.
But we agree if it's a stolen firearm or classified as illegal, all firearms basically started as a legal manufactured firearm in the United States of America, correct?
Yeah, but again, that's somewhat irrelevant to the point I was making, which is that the guns
are
obtained illegally.
It's relevant to the point I'm making, dear sir.
Sure. Okay, so what's the point?
Okay, so my point is this. You have more guns than people in the United States of America. Mm-hmm. The United States of America has the highest per capita homicide rate. We are one of the absolute most crime-ridden places on the planet Earth as it relates to gun violence.
In the first world.
Mass shootings. We have more mass shootings than any other developed nation, except for 1 year. That was one caveat. But every other year for the last 30 years, it's been us. It's been America. We don't have the most in population. We're not the most violent on television. As a matter of fact, there are other countries that have more violent content than we do. But we are number one. We're number one in gun violence. And I submit to you, we're number one in gun violence because of the access to guns and our infatuation with gun culture in the United States of America. So when you talk about illegal guns, understand that every single illegal gun started as a legal gun in the United States of America. My point is, if we limit access to guns, if we limit access to weaponry, remember, all weapons, all categories of weapons started legal. Do you not believe it would limit or decrease some of the carnage we see through gun violence in America?
I sadly don't, because from 1993 to 2018, the homicide rate dropped by 49%, according to Pew Poll Research. According to the FBI, it dropped by 40%. And in that time, gun ownership went up tremendously, tremendously in that time, legal gun ownership. And even within that, a lot of the laws that people are trying to pass were actually around back then. Like the assault weapon ban ended in 2004.
You brought up the assault weapon ban, dear sir. That proves my point. During the assault weapon ban, guess what went down? Murders related to assault weapons. You know
sure,
that, right?
And homicide went up. It dropped after the ban from 2004.
When the ban was in place, you had a sharp, significant, statistical decrease in the number of crimes committed using that kind of weapon.
But overall homicide from 2014 to 2018, forget 1993, just from that ban, dropped 20%. In other words, statistically speaking, since the ban of assault weapons ended, we had a 20% reduction in homicide. If assault weapons were such a threat to society, we would have seen a spike in overall homicide. Assault weapons are used in less than 1%. All rifles are used in less than 3% of homicide. So assault weapons are extremely low on the...
Let's go back, man, because yes, I promise you, students who have been shot by assault rifles or semi-automatic weaponry, they would disagree with you or the parents
and teachers. Don't play that game with me.
Ain't nobody playing a damn game with you. First of all, I don't play games. I'm serious about what I say and what I do.
It's the you don't care about human life because I'm not on the same page as you on this argument.
Do you understand? Nobody's playing with you. You get that, right?
You don't care. It's the same tactic used anytime people debate about gun control. It's my biggest pet peeve because it shuts down the debate and it tries to paint the people who disagree with
you. I'm not shutting down the damn thing.
I care about human life the same amount as you.
Sir, I'm 10 toes down. I'm right here. The debate is ongoing. My point to you is when there was a ban on assault weapons as it relates to crimes went down in America. There's a direct correlation. It's called cause and effect. How you don't see that, I don't quite understand. But I appreciate you being on the program. Thank you, sir.